Father God, we thank you for that resurrection day. We thank you for the fact that you did die on a cross for us, shed your blood, that we might be free from our sins when we realize that, accept that, confess our sins. Thank you, Father, we've come today to worship a living God. So, thank you for what you've done thus far in the service. Thank you for what you're going to do in the remainder of the time that we have here. Lord, you are a good God. And we come today to worship you. We come today to praise you. We come today to glorify your holy name. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Thank you, Keith. Thank you, praise team. Turn in your Bibles, if you will, today to the book of James over in near the back of your Bible. And we're going to look at some of the things, some of the challenges that James was facing with the early church. Now, week before last week, of course, we had the snow. We didn't get to worship here. I hope you worshiped at home. But I was still kind of in that New Year's mode, and I was kind of thinking, now what is it that I need most of all to move forward in 2017? And one of the first things that I realized that I need is a closer walk, a closer encounter with Jesus Christ. That's one of the things I need. But what are some of the other things that I need that might help me as I move forward, help me to be a better servant of God? And one of the things that come to my attention fairly quickly was what James is talking about in his book, patience. Now, I know that you don't need that, but I think maybe I do, and I just want to share with you a little bit today about my needs. James talks about two things, and next Sunday we're going to follow the second thing, but he talks about two things. One, James talks about the church having patience. Having patience. So let's read the scripture, and then we will get back and dissect it and eventually get to our outline. James, the very first chapter, and we're going to be reading the first four verses and then slip over and pick up the 12th verse. James, a servant of God and the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad. James, many believe that this was not the Apostle James. The Apostle James was killed early when the real persecution began at the churches. So we're thinking this is James, the half-brother of Jesus Christ. You know, Jesus' family didn't even recognize him as being the Savior. At least the children didn't. I'm so sure Mary and Joseph knew that something powerful was going on in their boy's life. But the family did not. And James became a believer and very instrumental in the early church after the resurrection of Jesus Christ. James saw. He didn't see the actual resurrection, the crucifying and the actual resurrection. But he saw and encountered this Jesus after he had rose from the grave. And then at that time, he knew that this was his brother. But he knew that it was even more than that now. And James began to be a very instrumental individual in the early church. Now the early church is scattered. The persecution scattered the early church all over the land. And incidentally, the early church was mainly Jews. It was a Jewish church. It didn't expand out to you and I as Gentiles until a little later on as the church continued to be persecuted, continued to spread out, and then it began to reach and you and I began to have that invitation from the early church. Now, saying that, let me say this. This church should never exclude anyone from its body, from its worshiping. We should include all involved, all people involved, because we cannot shut out the grace of God, the love of God, the mercy of God, and the forgiveness of God to others that Jesus died for as well as he died for you and I. I'm glad that the Jews were scattered because I received the message as a result of their being dispersed out from Jerusalem and then going all over the world. So just this is who James was writing to. He was writing to the early, mainly Jewish church that had a mission for God to share God's love with all. James called himself a servant. That word can be, the Greek word is doulos. It can mean a servant. It can mean a slave. And James, I think, was really referring to himself here as a slave of Jesus Christ. And I think that he was saying, I'm glad to be that slave of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. And the 12 tribes were the 12 tribes of Israel that had been scattered out and were beginning to share the gospel. Then James in the second verse said something that sometimes it's a little difficult for me to wrap my mind around it. James said, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations. What? You mean when we are tempted and when we are persecuted, when we are laughed at, when we are mocked, we should count it a joy? That's exactly what James is saying. And listen to me now. James was telling this early church, because when we know the results of what we're going through, that is going to eventually become a good result. We're going to eventually become a more mature Christian. Matter of fact, James calls it perfect. When we know the end results of what we're going through, and we know that God is allowing it in order to make us a better person, a better servant, a better doulos, and we know that somewhere down the road that others are going to be affected by it, then when we know that what we're going through has some good results from God, then it makes it easier to bear it. As a matter of fact, James says, count it joy. Count it joy. I don't know where you are. I don't know what your troubles are. But I know that all of us have them. We're all tempted. We all go through difficult times. And when we know that God allows these things to happen to us to make us a better person, then we can cope with our situation better. We may not laugh, ha 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 ha, but we can know that God has something good. As a matter of fact, the scripture in the Bible that I use quite often, and we know that all things work together to good for them that love the Lord, Romans 8:28. We don't always know that, at least I don't. But if the Bible says it, my friends, we can bank on it. We can know that it is true. We can know that it is real. So James is telling the Jewish church, a mainly Jewish church now, that is scattered away from Jerusalem. And the Jews thought that Jerusalem was the only place that you could really worship, because every time that they would pray, wherever they were, they would turn their eyes towards Jerusalem and pray. They were scattered all over in pagan countries. But yet God had a plan. And my friends, I don't know where you are or what's going on in your life, but let me remind you that the end result is God has a plan. God has a plan. Picking up at verse 3. Knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. Patience sometimes is, well, patience is not inherited. It's not in our genes. I know we often look back and said, well, he or she had a good mom, he or she had a good dad. Certainly, but patience is something that they had to work on just like you and I need to work on. It's not in our genes, it's not inherited. It's something that we as individuals deal with. Now let's take a look at this fourth verse. But let your patience have her, some of you virgin says it's, and that's okay, have its perfect work. It seems to me as I read this passage that patience works out in our lives when we use it the right way, when we don't fly apart, when we don't have those temper tantrums, when we don't have that road rage, that patience will make us a better person. As a matter of fact, James calls it perfect. That word in the Greek language can be translated mature. Mature. A lot of us, when we think about patience, and we know our limits on patience, a lot of us, if we were truthful, would identify ourselves as being very immature. Very immature. So James goes on. But let patience have its perfect work. Now listen to the next phrase. That you may be perfect. That you may be perfect. You say, well, I can't be perfect. And I've said the same thing, and Mama agrees with me. But are we calling James a liar? Ever thought of it that way? James seemed to think it is through our patience, and of course faith is involved in all of this as well, through our patience we can become a perfect individual. Now we still live in these carnal bodies, don't get me wrong. We still live in these carnal bodies. We're still going to have those things that tempt us and draw us back. But let me tell you something about temptation. And this very passage goes on a little further on down and reminds us that God does not tempt. So there is a difference between temptation and trials. There is a difference between temptation and trials. Temptation is things that our carnal nature kindly tempts us with. Now, it is not sin to have an evil thought. It is not sin to have an evil thought. But it is sin to act upon that evil thought. That's where the sin comes in. We control our minds. And when that evil thought comes in, we need to weed it out immediately. No, I'm not going there. I've been there and it didn't do me any good. As a matter of fact, it done me harm. And I'm not going there this time. Trials are things that happen because God, an all-knowing God, knows that we have some things in our lives that we need to work on, we need to adjust to. And somehow, patience must have been a big thing in the early church. And my friends, it's a big thing in the 21st century church too. The other week, I had gone out to get me some lunch. Turned in to go down to Wendy's, you know, off of 122 this way and that way. And there was a car coming down. And he was way back. I could have went ahead and cut in. I was going through the drive-thru. And I thought, well, I'll just wait and let him come on by. I had my blinker on. He knew where I was going. About time he got up at me, he turned his blinker on. I knew where he was going. He was going to get in front of me. And he did. And it took him 30 minutes to order. Not that long, but I realized that this message was not as much for you as it was for me. After letting that soak in a little bit, and when I left, I always go out to use the stoplight. That's what you do when you're my age, at least that's what I do. Let the stoplight let me in. And there was a whole line of cars coming out of Kroger's up there to that stoplight to get in the other road to go to the next stoplight. And there was a car coming out of Kroger's, and if I'd have went on up, I would have blocked that car. So I thought, now, I'm going to be nice today. I just stopped back and let that car go in. So that made me feel better about what happened at Wendy's. But anyway, I need to work on my patience. I let little things disturb me. I wish that I got so disturbed over spirit, got as disturbed over spiritual things as I do over literal things, little things that I shouldn't allow to upset me or steal my joy or take away my day. I wished I got as upset over spiritual things, and that is that there are people all around me every day, everywhere, that is lost. There's people that needs love. There's people that needs encouragement. There's people that just need somebody to smile at them once in a while. Patience is what James is talking about. Let's finish the reading and then we'll get to our outline just for a few moments. But let patience have her perfect works, that you may be perfect and entire. Entire simply meaning complete, that you may be that complete Christian. Probably we've never thought that my impatience is what's keeping me from being all that God wants me to be. Such a little thing, but such a big thing. Such a control thing. We don't need committees to help us work on our patience. We are the committee. We do chair that committee. And we decide whether or not we are going to control our patience or whether or not our patience is going to control us or our impatientness is going to control us. That is our decision. I'm talking about moving into a new year now. This is not a New Year's message, but if we want to be better people, if we want to be a better church for God, James is telling us to let patience have her perfect works, that we may become perfect and entire, meaning all that God has called us to be. Don't go home telling somebody that the preacher said, I can be perfect. We cannot in this carnal body. But let me tell you something. We can be a lot closer to it than we are right now. If I was in a Pentecostal church, they would have shouted over that. Now let's hop over and pick up one verse over in the 12th verse of the first chapter, down to verse 12. Blessed or blessed is the man, and this is woman too, that endureth temptation. That endureth temptation, that somehow we overcome the tempter, or the tempter overcomes us, one or the other. But we, my friends, has a choice. Can't think of his name now, but some of you will tell me his name. A comedian on Sunday night television a long time ago said, the devil made me do it. Who was it? Flip Wilson, yeah. The devil made me do it. Well, let me tell you, the devil, listen to me. You're a child of God. If you've accepted Jesus Christ, the devil can't make you do anything. He don't have the power. He don't have the power to make you or I do anything. When temptation comes, and they do, we control how we respond to those temptations. We control how we respond to those temptations. Blessed is the man that endureth temptations, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life. The crown of life. Let me just insert a couple of little things here, and then we'll move on. There are five crowns that the Bible speaks of that we can receive after death. You say, we're going to be crowns in heaven? Are we going to have different levels in heaven? No, we aren't. In heaven, we're going to be more. We're going to be exactly like God created us to be, where we didn't feel that we were better than anybody else, and anybody else didn't feel that we were better than they. That's the way we're going to be. But those five crowns will be issued, and they will be issued fairly by God himself, by Jesus Christ, his son, that not only knows about us, but knows us. Now, what's going to happen? Are there going to be people walking around in heaven with crowns on the head? Walking around and, I'm good, I'm better than you? No, not at all. You know, whenever the person, then the Bible says this, whenever a person receives something from God, they lay it back down at the feet of Jesus Christ, because it's only because of Jesus Christ that one was able to attain any of those rewards. Now, expanding on that just a little bit. When Jesus issued the rewards in heaven, the mindset is to immediately put it back where it belongs. Now listen to me. You and I have received one of the greatest blessings that is receivable in this life. Now, it's not a Super Bowl ring. It's not some trophy. It is by salvation we have received the grace, the mercy, the love, the forgiveness of an almighty God. Now, what are we to do with that? We are to glorify God. We are to glorify God in our walk. In our walk with him. So blessed is the man that endureth temptations. For when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to them that love him. You know, God knows how much we love him. He knows that. And we do too. You know, we don't love God like we love in the same manner that we love people here. I mean, that love is the same thing. But listen to me. The way that we show God we love him is not by walking up and hugging him, or putting our arms around him, or shaking his hand, or coming to church, or reading the Bible, or singing the songs, or shouting, whatever we do. It is by obeying his very command in our lives. That is what brings glory to God. That is what brings glory to God. Let's fill in a few blanks, and we'll do it very quickly. My subtitle was The Sweet Fruits of Bitter Times. Now, I'm not going to go all the way with this today, because it's a little later in the sermon and it might take away from what we've done. But you know what this is. This is a Krispy Kreme donut. I went by, Mom and I did Food Lion yesterday in Bedford, and I got a box. And I should have got two boxes, and I'd had some left for today, but these things, you know how they taste. They're great. They are great. But before they become this great, they go through a process. Of course, the grain is harvested, grinded up into dust, and then the dough is made from that. And then once the dough is made and they're laid out, and I know this is a production process, not like we do it at home, and then the holes are shot in them by air, And then they go through hot water and hot grease, boiling water and boiling grease. And then they go through a time of temperature change so that the dough will rise. And then they go under a cascade of this sweet honey glow that is on top of them and makes them good. But none of us would want to eat a donut before the process was complete. Before the process was complete. And my friends, God wants His process in our lives to be complete so that we can be a better witness in the world that we live in. So that I was going to eat one, Dexter, but I decided not to right now. And these are off limits for anybody after the service, okay? I got to have them for the next service, all right? So let's look at our outline very quickly. First of all, patience, as we're speaking of today, is very passive. That means that we tolerate whatever God sends our way, whether it be a trial or whether it be a temptation that we create in our own minds. We tolerate them. We don't say, why me? We don't try to get rid of them. We know that all things work together to good to them that love the Lord and are called according to His purpose. When we know, it makes it easier, not better. We don't laugh. We don't shout about having them. But we know that the end is coming, and somewhere we're going to have that sweet spiritual taste as the donut has. So that makes it a little easier. So the patience that we're talking about today is passive, talking about the joy. Let's move on. It's active, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. It should be active in our lives. Yeah, we have that button that you push that will try our patience, but we control that button, and we need to do a better job, at least I do, of trying to control that button. Thirdly, it's productive. Patience is productive. It means that the more we deal with them in the right way, that the better they become, the more control we have over them, and we can use them for good. You know, patience sometimes is putting up with something we would rather not put up with. But we continue to put up with it, and we continue to pray for it and pray about it. Don't ever give up on praying for someone that you love. Don't ever mark them off of your prayer list, because God has never and never will give up on them either. God has not and never will. So it's productive. And then we're looking at the patience and the perfectness. We've already talked about that, so we'll move on through that. And then lastly, it's exemplary. Patience is an example. You know what people realize is when we lose our patience, they don't ever forget that. They don't ever forget that. If we lose it and we're very ugly with it, they don't ever forget that. So being able to control our patience is an example to the rest of the world. I wound up over in Job doing this study, because we had 2 weeks. Job was a man that he really went through some stuff, and even James mentions him here in the ending of his story. But I was reading the last chapter of Job, and chapter 42, verse 12. So the Lord blessed the latter end of Job more than he did in the beginning. Job went through a lot and a long time, and he had three friends. Supposing friends that sat with him and tried to console him, but somehow they only condemned him. Don't be a condemner. Don't be a condemner. Be a consoler in the right way. And sometimes consoling. You know, I have people to tell me in certain situations that I don't know what to say. That's why I don't go. That's why I don't visit this individual. I don't know what to say. Well, let me tell you, it's not what you say, it's just your presence. Your presence means more than any therapeutic counseling or anything of that nature can do for anyone. Just your patience, just your love, and just your showing them that you care about them. A big old bear hug is always good. I love to hug, do bear hugs on these old big macho men in their camouflage outfit, you know. You go up to hug them and they'll back away, but they melt when you hug them. They melt when you hug them. So be an example. Let your patience be an example to others that they don't always have to be throwing temper tantrums. They don't always have to be hating, but patience can be a big part of my loving you and standing by you wherever you are, whatever you're doing, and praying for you. My patience can wait upon the Lord. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength, Isaiah said. So James is talking to us about patience. And then, Hebrew, I was going to use that, but time doesn't allow us to do that. But patience is passive, it's active, it's productive, and it is an example to others. A lot of times as to who we are. Pick this up somewhere in my studies, that we as Christians should focus on our position in Christ. We don't have to be preaching. We don't have to be singing in the praise team or the choir. We don't have to be a full-time missionary to be important to God. We are important to God. Don't ever forget that. We are important to God. I'm a child of God. You know, I kind of dislike, I guess I'm back to patience again, aren't I? Television preachers that has you repeating something. And I've never really done that much. But I'm going to kind of break that now. I'm going to kind of break that. And I want you to say this with me. Are you ready? I am. Okay, now, I want to get back to a little bit now when Keith says that let's give God a hand and let's show a little more exciting in the things that belongs to God. There you go, Brenda. Let's feel a little more excited about that. I am a child of God. Regardless of what's going on in my day-to-day life, if I have accepted Christ, I am a child of God. My clicker's kind of trying my patience today, too. All right, again, I have been born again. All right. And then, Christ lives in me. All right. Maybe those preachers are going to something. I can win over temptation. God has given me the power. Amen. Let's go over one more time and kind of be a little more enthusiastic. You ready? Let me hear you. Father, thank you for your challenge to this pastor today. Maybe somebody else sitting out front, I don't know. But Father, may I realize that my life, my actions is controllable by me. You have empowered me to be all that I need to be for you. I just need to choose to be that. In Jesus' name, amen.